I'll be speaking on anesthesia for nasal endoscopy. As I was preparing for this topic, suddenly I woke up with this nightmare. What if I had to give anesthesia to this? And then I woke up properly and I realized, no, these are my patients. So these are the usual patients that come for nasal endoscopy. You have patients for maxillary sinusitis and polyposis, mucormycosis in diabetic patients, tumors for biopsies and excisions, and JNAs, endoscopic excision of JNAs, which are done quite a lot in our institute. Others are DCR, treatment of CSF rhinorrhea, and the latest kid on the block, drug-induced sleep endoscopy, which is done for diagnosis of obstructive sleep apnea. So you can just see what is the scope of nasal endoscopy, right from sinonasal surgeries, cranial and skull-based surgeries, to orbital surgeries. And as the chairperson pointed out, what are the anesthesia challenges? What do you think are the anesthesia challenges? Main thing is that there is airway sharing. You're competing for space within that small airway. The endotracheal tube that you have placed is covered under the drapes. The surgeon keeps moving the head and the endotracheal tube. So there can be frequent disconnections of the circuit, which again under the drapes you're struggling to find out. And there is quite a bit of manipulation of the airway, which can give rise to a massive hemodynamic response, which takes us to the second concern, that is the surgical field. So traditionally, we have been using something called controlled hypotension to maintain the surgical field. But I think it should be said controlled hemodynamics, because it is not just hypotension that we are talking about. And this is done so that bleeding is prevented in the field, and therefore they can go ahead with the procedure. At the same time, the vital structures in the vicinity are protected. The third challenge is rapid titration of anesthesia at emergence. One moment, the patient has to be deep enough to allow their endoscopy and nasal packing, and the next moment, he has to be awake, regain his airway reflexes, avoid straining coughing, and smoothly extubate the patients without aspirating blood secretions or vomitus. So this is quite a bit of challenge. So how do we go about? First, we start with our usual preoperative assessment. Now, all the others remain the same, but if the patient has sinusitis, then he may have allergic rhinitis and atopy. If there is polyposis, look out for the Samter's triad. They can have asthma along with their polyposis, and they are allergic to aspirin. They will react with a severe bronchoconstriction, and this is true even about other NSAIDs. If they have a nasal block, then further find out, do they have an obstructive sleep apnea? Epistaxis, rule out other bleeding diastasis. If there are airway tumors, you may have a difficult mask ventilation, difficult intubation, or both. And there may be invasion into the orbit, the oral cavity, or the CNS, and accordingly, you will have symptoms of those systems. If they have rhinorrhea, remember that airway sensitivity lasts for almost 4 to 6 weeks, so you may have to decide the timing of your elective surgery. And if they come with OSA, then the stop bank questionnaire should be administered to find out the risk of obstructive sleep apnea complications in the postoperative period. Comorbidities, again, usual comorbidities, but in these three, the triad of diabetes, hypertension, and ischemic heart disease, we have to determine the blood pressure threshold, which we will allow, the ability to tolerate the local vasoconstrictors, and they may be on antiplatelet and anticoagulant therapy, which you have to stop in consultation with the cardiologist. If they have asthma, obviously you need to optimize them well with bronchodilators because they will have an airway sensitivity and you are doing all airway manipulations. Of the addictions, tobacco, now this patients will require an oral intubation. So submucous fibrosis has to be ruled out. And again, airway sensitivity if they are smoking. In the routine examination, you will emphasize and see what is the baseline pulse rate, because you will be using drugs to control the pulse rate in the intraoperative period. So you have to rule out baseline bradycardia. And then again, as I have said, the hypotension threshold has to be set, so you need to know all the baseline parameters. Examine the RS for optimization of the bronchodilators, and airway and local examination specific to oral intubation. Of all the investigations, various routine institutional protocols are there, but you have to be wary about anemia of chronic sinusitis, leukocytosis, which will indicate that there is active infection, or eosinophilia in allergic cases. So how do you plan your anesthesia? Either you can give monitored anesthesia care, local anesthesia with sedation, or standard general anesthesia with an endotracheal tube. Whatever be your choice of anesthesia, this is a very important step. You have to counsel the patients that the nose will be blocked with a nasal pack at the end of the surgery and they have to breathe through the mouth. Believe me, it is very important to tell this because otherwise patients have a feeling of respiratory distress because they feel that they cannot breathe through the mouth. All patients, you have a common preoperative preparation. Glucocorticosteroids are given, especially with patients with higher lung MACE scores, which just is an indicator of opacification. The more the sinuses are opacified, you will give them steroids. And rhinitis medicamentosa, where they have a resistance to local vasoconstrictor because they have been using it habitually. Antibiotics, topical vasoconstrictors with or without local anesthesia for nasal packing, pain medications preemptively, inhaled bronchodilators to optimize the chest condition, and routine fasting guidelines. These are common for all procedures. Intravenous access, preferably on the left hand, because you will see, I will show you how the ergonomics of the operation theater work when an endoscopy is going on. You are on the left, so preferably on the left side. What are the advantages of local anesthesia? You have an ability, the patient may signal pain, so damage to vital structures can be prevented. There is decreased blood loss and a better surgical feel because all this intubation response and everything is avoided. It can be the surgical demand, as in drug-induced sleep endoscopy. It does have a better recovery profile with decreased incidence of nausea and faster discharge. But patients have to be selected carefully. They have to be cooperative adults. Their physical status needs to be optimized because they can require general anesthesia at any moment in time. The strength and total dose of local anesthetic solution as well as the vasoconstrictor needs to be calculated carefully and done. Local anesthetics, usual local anesthetics are used, and all of us are aware that this is the spectrum of local anesthetic toxicity, starting from lightheadedness to numbness of tongue to serious depression. But we have a recent report in our IJA December issue where brainstem anesthesia was seen following intranasal packing with lignocaine and adrenaline. So one has to be careful about this. When they are packing, you be careful. Adrenaline, a friend of the ENT surgeons, okay? So we very nicely tell them, maximum concentration you can use is 1 in 1 lakh and do not exceed 5 microgram per kg per hour, but be very wary, okay? They will lie to you. They have long noses, okay? They can be using anything from, means the highest concentration I have been told that I have been using is 1 in 50,000. But I have seen residents emptying half an ampule, one ampule into that 30 cc vial. And then they, you know, remove the label and say this is our ear solution, this is our nose solution. So be very careful. The point is that there may be ventricular bigeminy, ventricular tachycardia. So be vigilant and monitor these patients very, very carefully when they are giving adrenaline. And of course, our usual precautions, if you're using halothane during general anesthesia, that time you have to be more careful. What about sedation? This is what the ASA has recommended in 2014. These are our spectrum of sedation, okay? So what we need is moderate sedation or conscious sedation with analgesia. There has to be a purposeful response to verbal or tactile stimulation. And no intervention is to be required for maintenance of airway, respiration, or cardiovascular function. So this is what is our ideal plane of anesthesia. And that corresponds to around 2, 3, 4 of the modified Ramsey sedation score. You can use whatever scale you want, but those are our targets. And these are the various techniques that are used, benzodiazepine, midazolam, or propofol infusion, or Dexmed nowadays, which is a very safe infusion, properly given. And you can add an analgesic, whatever is available to you. But remember, that is what our target was, moderate level of sedation. But it is a continuum of sedation. So patient can go into deep sedation, can progress into general anesthesia. So you have to be highly vigilant for airway, breathing, and circulation, and keep all emergency measures ready to resuscitate to the patient or to maintain the airway as and when required. What about general anesthesia? When we say general anesthesia, control of hemodynamics becomes our territory. So now what we do is we try to maintain the pulse rate to the lower range of normal, do not allow a reduction in SVP to more than 30% of baseline, and that too in ASA grade 1 patients. In hypertensives, you will have to be more careful. In fact, recent studies say that you maintain within 10% of the baseline and SVP should remain above 100, and mean arterial pressures should not be allowed to go down less than 65. In fact, what we have seen is if you control the pulse rate well, even with a mean arterial pressure more than 65, there is no bleeding, there is no problem in the surgical field. So that chasing of MAP, we should be avoiding. How will we do this? Preoperatively counsel the patient, reduce his anxiety, give him oral sedation, analgesics as required. Intraoperatively position the patient as well as your endotracheal tube properly. Maintain an adequate depth of anesthesia, deepen it when you feel there is going to be a painful procedure. Multimodal analgesia, and when you required, last resort is non-anesthetic drugs. Now intubation, SGADs are becoming so common, and there are a few reports where there are some advantages of SGADs, that there is decreased hemodynamic response, better field, smooth emergence, fast turnover. And some of them have said that when they have put in a fiber optic scope, there was very less debris and blood on the LMA. But if it gets dislodged or there is obstruction, then, and there is, what they have said is even a slightly misplaced SGAD can cause fogging and blood on the endoscopic camera. So what I feel is that intubation and securing the airway is the golden standard, and we, in our institute, we follow this, that we are intubating patients with nasal endoscopic surgeries. Standard GA technique with endotracheal intubation, your anti-sialagogue needs to be given. Now again, as Dr. Manish has said, your antiemetics, acid prophylaxis has to be timed that it will act in the post-operative period. And dexamethasone these days is really working as a wonder drug if you look at it. It has post-operative nausea, vomiting, post-operative pain, edema. So it's a good drug to give in nasal endoscopy. Anxiolytics and opioid analgesics, as usual, depending on the duration of surgery, you can decide. Propofol is preferred induction agent because of its bronchodilator actions, but you can tailor your anesthesia according to the situation. Similarly with your muscle relaxation. A cuffed endotracheal tube, as I said, is the golden standard. A routine tube can be fixed to the left. It has to be fixed to the left because the surgeon is to the right and they approach the nasal cavity from the right side. A flexible non-kinkable tube can be fixed to the left or the center. Or south polar preformed RAE tube can be fixed. Whatever be the choice of your tube, hypopharyngeal packing or throat packing is a must. So this is how we do it. We have fixed the tube to the left. It is, you can see it is draped. So you see to it that all your connections are tightened and there is no scope for disconnection. And slightly you keep this sticking, like a mesenteric sticking, allowing a little movement when the head is tilted and head is moved so that, you know, the tube does not come out. Because if you fix it very tightly and they fix the drapes, you will have that. And as you can see, the machine is to the left. So, and all your warming devices, IV fluids, everything will be from the foot end. So you have the foot end and you have the left of the patient. As I said, position your patient well. So you can give a reverse Trendelenburg position. Every 2.5 centimeter above heart level decreases the blood pressure by 2 millimeters of mercury. A 10 degree tilt is enough to improve the surgical feel, and up to 30 degrees cerebral perfusion is maintained. So optimally 10 to 20 degrees is what we can use. Well, you need to watch for air embolism and see to it that there is no flexion when you do this, otherwise venous congestion will worsen the field. And one thing they have suggested is that use that clinometer that is available on the OT tables, because you may underestimate or overestimate visually what the degree of head high that you're giving. Intubation response, all the traditional techniques, whatever is needed, can be used. For maintenance of anesthesia, for a long time now, there was a research going on that propofol is better because it has less myocardial depression, decreases the cardiac output, and capillary density was better, and bleeding within the ethmoid cells is less because it is autoregulated. Now, what the recent Cochrane review, however, says is that one thing is there are only four trials, no new trials since 2013. but there is no decrease in total blood loss. Means the field condition is better, but total blood loss and operative time has not improved with propofol, and more RCTs have been recommended. But I think in view of the waste gases and all that are there with inhalationals, you can, I do prefer propofol for nasal endoscopy. Now, if there is, again, there are some problems with the field and the surgeon is complaining, you reassess everything. Multimodal analgesia forms an important part of your armamentarium. Use local anesthesia plus vasoconstrictors, that is patties that they will be using. Again, adrenaline, it will be pure adrenaline that they are putting in their packs. Paracetamol 1 gram IV, suppositories at 30 milligram per kg, and other NSAIDs can be added to improve the analgesia. Rule out increased airway pressure. As you said, as I said, there are drapes. So there may be kinking, there may be an otopy phenomenon, there may be hypercapnia. So rule all this out. And if all this has been ruled out and still there is hypertension, then you can give your alpha 2 agonist, beta blockers, or NTG infusion. Recent reports obviously say that the beta blockers or the dexmedetomidine are better because NTG itself vasodilates. It vasodilates the veins, and hence there can be worsening of the field. Other methods of controlling bleeding are use of corticosteroids, as I said. Tranexamic acid can be given at 10 mg per kg IV. Some reports of local application are also there that it can help. Hot saline local application can help. And in longer duration nasal endoscopy, see to it that the temperature is maintained. At concerns at extubation, thorough suction, the throat pack is removed, no fresh bleeding or pooling of blood needs to be there. Control extubation response with non-anesthetic measures. Patient has to be completely awake, calm and pain-free. Meet your extubation criteria, maintaining saturation and vitals, and ensure that the antiemetics have been given. Postoperative pain is usually mild to moderate and easily controlled. Opioids are not required. Sphenobalatine blocks or local anesthesia infused nasal placking can be done. Nausea and vomiting due to blood in the stomach, inflammation due to your throat pack, opioids or nitrous oxide may be there. As I said, time your antiemetics well, repeat them if required. What do you watch for in the postoperative period? Bleeding. There can be soakage of the nasal pack, post-nasal bleeding, which can be seen by excessive swallowing. Airway obstruction due to edema, laryngospasm, bronchospasm, or migration of the nasal pack, and orbital compression, which can be seen with ecchymosis, proptosis, pupillary diameter changes, or changes in vision and CSF leak. A few concerns, JNA, specific concerns, bleeding, so preoperative embolization and autologous donation, and for hemorrhage control, you will have to take central line, arterial line may be required. Intracranial extension is usually done with neuronavigation. And for orbital hematoma, they check the eye pupil frequently. So the eyes are not taped shut like in other surgeries. CSF rhinorrhea, they may ask you to insert a lumbar drain. Fibrous tissues in DCR do that present a problem that you can't control bleeding at that stage. For your drug-induced sleep endoscopy, it is a short duration procedure, but they are obese patients, there is chance of regurgitation aspiration. You require a dark, quiet OT environment. Midazolam plus or minus fentanyl, propofol and Dexmed have been used. So our points are that you have to share the airway, you need to control the surgical field, there has to be smooth emergence and recovery. Preoperatively, as I said, rule out reactive airways, SAMTERS triad and comorbidities can be done under monitored anesthesia care, conscious sedation, or general anesthesia with endotracheal intubation and throat pack. For your control of field, local anesthetic and vasoconstrictor use, adequate depth of anesthesia, multimodal analgesia, and adequate relaxation are sufficient. If required, you can use alpha-2 agonists or beta blockers. Postoperative pain and nausea vomiting are issues which need to be tackled. And in the postoperative period, watch for airway, bleeding, eyes, and CSF leaks. Even I can have a sigh of relief now. Thank you.